Carl, the film you made is a very fascinating film about practices of fantasy. And what I would like to know first is, do you feel what your protagonists are doing, like constructing these elaborate fantasy worlds, is this something empowering, or is this something rather regressive because it's so much like kind of a withdrawing from like actual lived reality? Was that even a question for you making this film?
Absolutely, and it's a great question actually, because of course the main theme is that drawing and reading shota is actually empowering. Of course, now I have zoned in on a certain demographics or a certain group of readers who all identify as gay men and who use shota in order to sort of go back and reclaim their childhoods and boyhoods and growing up to relive a better version of them. That's what I could relate to myself. But at the same time, we have Zach, who is the main protagonist of the film, who I think that everyone who watches the film senses that he is not really happy, and he is actually diverging into otaku realm, so to speak.
How stressful ordinary reality is, no?
Sorry?
He talks a lot about how stressful ordinary reality
exactly. And he talks about how he is tempted by the hikikomori, the people who sort of withdraw from society. And when he watched the film, he said that he didn't recognize himself. He loved the film very much, but he said that you managed to capture me at a time, and that Zach doesn't exist anymore. And that was very positive, because now he had dared to download a gay dating app, and he was about to go on a date and so on. So we actually
have anything to do with your filmmaking, with this process?
Maybe. Yeah, that's a good question, because he is also a very interesting research participant in the sense that he was very happy to meet us by chance, basically, at a shota event, me and my cinematographer, Solomon McConnell. And we spent a lot of time together. And for Zach, the importance of that was that he could articulate things that he had thought about a lot. And maybe that contributed to him realizing things about himself, or being a catalyst, at least, who knows.
I loved how you integrated yourself into the film. Can you talk a bit about how you arrived at this decision of like making your personality and your positionality and also your past such an important part of the film?
Well, it was of course a process, it took a lot of thought actually before I decided to integrate myself in the film. But my supervisor, who was Dr. Andy Lawrence, he had recommended me from the start to save up, to film in a way that would make it possible to include myself in the film. And partly it's a technical decision, because since all my research participants are anonymous, it becomes frustrating after a while to never see a face in a movie. So we have Hatta-san of Alice Books, who sort of represents some kind of authority. He's not a shota fan himself. And then we have me, and maybe the audience can somehow relate. Maybe I can be some kind of bridge between my research participants and the audience maybe the audience as well can start thinking about their pasts and what the ideal outcome of their pasts would be. So something along those lines. But it was also very emotional for me to actually hear Zach sit there and talk about his past and realize that this is not so unlike me, despite we come from totally different countries and we are different generations and all that.
Mm. No, I think that worked super well, like kind of having you as this cultural translator, because like, on a first glance, this world looks so alien to us. So like, you know, but you really made it relatable. And I think like a lot of the power of the film actually comes from that. Staying with the topic of power and empowerment, is is this idea of empowerment something you wanted to achieve with this film? Like, did you have any ideas of like the impact you wanted the film to have, like on the lives of your research participants or on your audience? Is that something you thought of?
Well, that's a hard question. I mean, what I basically wanted was that I wanted to understand an experience, how my research participants experience desire, because it is a very controversial topic, not in Japan necessarily, but in many parts of the world, to be sexually attracted to a fictional character which represents some kind of, or maybe not represents, but which looks like a child or a boy. So I wanted to understand that experience, and I was actually quite wary that I didn't want to come into this with my own preconceptions or the prejudices of the world that I live in. So I didn't want to make a political film, actually. Now, this comes in naturally anyway, partly because Zach is not Japanese. He doesn't want to reveal where he comes from, but he is part of the Western culture, you could say, has watched the same American shows as I have. And so he brings that up about feeling shame, feeling that the outside world doesn't understand him or what this is about. And I think that, after all, I did this at a German university, and I even had to seek legal counseling. That's what my supervisor advised me, because what I would do might be illegal, actually, because it might be caught by child porn legislation. So since I am at a German university, in a way, it was not bad to bring in this political angle as well, but to do it a little bit in an maybe activist way, that they can, that my protagonists can explain a little bit about that it's more complicated than at first glance, maybe.
Okay, I was also very curious about the camera person in your film, Carl, because you were kind of like, there were always intimate conversations and there was this kind of other person. I wonder if you can say something about that.
Absolutely. The cinematographer is Solomon McConnon, who went to the same program as me at Freie Universität Berlin, the MA in Visual and Media Anthropology. And we were in, I was in Japan once on my own and the second time with him. And I think the initial plan was that I would film a little bit more, but once I sort of migrated towards the side in front of the camera, he became the main cinematographer. And I think that the main challenge with that was to film in a way that was anonymizing, because we were quite clear that we did not want to pixelate faces of the main protagonists or to change their voices or anything like that. So he had to film under a table or whatever. And I think it worked out in a way that all participants felt very comfortable with, actually.
So, but there also remains the question, is empowerment actually something we as anthropologists or social scientists should actually aim for? You know, there is, anthropology is one of these few social sciences that has this tradition of like kind of an engaged practice. And I would really like to know, like following your experience or your projects, what your ideas were making these projects or making future projects maybe as well.
I think that for shota fans in Japan, they are not a community. They know very little about each other. So that's why I was contacted by many of them who wanted to be part of this, but they partly wanted that because they wanted to know how other shota fans think about shota. I showed the film to a couple of game makers, programmers, who have made the game that features in the film also, and they got back to me and they had no idea that that people had these thoughts about Shota, but it made sense for them. So in that sense, I guess I have sort of a purpose to spread more knowledge about a phenomenon that to the people who actually engage in it.
My second and related question would be, maybe if we think about like these like larger media discourses about empowering representations of minority or underrepresented people in the media. No, I mean, Netflix and Amazon Studios and all these big companies, or Disney, are doing it in a way where you already feel it's like it becomes this new marketing instrument. No, if you think of like kind of a film like Black Panther that like easily crossed the $1 billion revenue. But then obviously in a lot of sections, like in state TV discussions, representation, like minorities are very often still like kind of talked about, but not talked with. And as this is such a convoluted and big topic nowadays, I keep asking myself what actually we as anthropologists can contribute to these like debates and what our specific perspective may be. And I wanted to find out if you maybe, because I don't have an answer to this. I thought maybe.
So I think that in my case, the empowerment actually goes the other way. It's like a reverse empowerment, because basically what I'm trying to do with my research is that I want to find out another way to look at how desire is connected to sexual identity. Because in the society where I live, sexual identity is so static and so important to people, and it is seen as something inborn and something like a truth that you can reveal. And to learn from my research participants another way to look at this, where people, okay, so who are not in the film, for example, but married family fathers who like Shota, or married women who like Shota, and who use it in various ways without any fear that that might say anything about their sexual identity. That, so Stefan, you also asked if I had a political motive and so on, and maybe that is it, that I want to complicate the picture that exists in other parts of the world.
Yeah, I think complicating the picture is always something we as anthropologists can and should strive for. Maybe we close by doing a quick round about what is next for all of you guys.
I will continue my Shota research during a PhD at the School of Arts, Languages and Cultures at the University of Manchester. And that starts now in September. So I am, nothing more to say about that. But it's a PhD in Japanese studies, by the way, not in anthropology. So I will bring my ethnographic methods in there.
Will you do another film, or will you expand that film? Or?
I'm open for everything. It's first of all, I want to actually write a book about Shota, but after I have written my dissertation. So yeah, it will be primarily a text-based PhD, I think, but I will continue to make films nevertheless.
Thank you very much for joining.